pretty go. And we are live, folks. Welcome to the Sit Down Standard, the podcast celebrating all the amazing things you could do while sitting, whether it's enjoying movies, watching television, or playing games. I'm one of your hosts, David Bray. I'm joined by the man who is more happy than Bill Clinton when he sees balloons, Gerald Bales.
Hi.
How are you?
Great.
All right.
He's so happy.
He is so happy.
Well, he's like, I've done this before, you know? Did you see, like, there was a girl trying to take his balloon away, and he was, like, snatching.
He's like the little kid with, like, a giant ball. Like, give me that. No. No,
he's,
I don't
like,
wanna...
kicking it around and stuff.
Definitely check that out if you haven't. Anyways.
Yeah, GNC is good stuff.
Exactly. And while you're at YouTube and checking out Bill Clinton playing with balloons, go to youtube.com/sitdownstandard. Watch our video podcast if you're listening to the audio version. Or, of course, you can find us on iTunes, SoundCloud, not soundcloud.com. I need to buy that URL.
And on the Google Play Store.
Google Play Store.
As confirmed.
As well as Stitcher Radio. And, you know, if you haven't in a while or if you haven't done it yet, go leave us a review on iTunes. Helps people find the
five
podcast.
Five stars. Let us know how we're doing.
All right.
Our voices sound.
Now that we've done that shameless promotion, let's get into what we talk about every week when we start the episode with. Oh, what you doing? Oh, what you doing? What you doing? Ba da da da. Ba 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 ba. By the way,
David's
50th episode. We're getting close. Folks, we're getting
big
close.
5-0. Two more to go.
We are going through midlife crisis right now. I'm going to buy a Corvette for this podcast.
I'm going to bang my maid.
Exactly. Illegitimate children for the podcast. All right. Anyways, what are you doing, Gerald? Or what you doing, Gerald?
Got a bunch of stuff, David.
Yeah, you had a busy week.
Let's do my weekly Overwatch update.
Yes. I know how much you love
Overwatch. Overwatch is great, guys. You still haven't started playing it. It's excellent.
Four people who haven't played it yet.
Yeah. Anyways, I did a little Overwatch drinking game. I used to do this back in the day with Halo 3. I think when we used to play.
Yes.
Is if you lose a game, you drink. You know, if you win, you keep going.
Problem is, you get worse.
No, actually, I think I get better, but I was drinking scotch, so
okay. Well,
I wasn't
that's
drinking
rough.
Beer. Yeah.
That's rough.
Yeah, I didn't know I drank like a third of the bottle. Anyways, right. I played 30 games. My record was 17-13, so a winning record.
Yeah,
and I felt like I did a lot better solo, and then I think you and Alex queued in for a few games, and then we lost a lot. And
what are you trying to
solo?
What are you trying to say?
I mean, I don't need you guys.
That's what it is. You and your bottle, that's all you need.
Yeah, anyway. Also, I got an invite from Blizzard yesterday to try out their new thing called Blizzard Streaming.
Okay.
This is new. I'm a beta invitee. Feel very honored.
Yeah, of course.
And it pretty much allows me to, at the touch of a button, stream any of your Blizzard games from the launcher to Facebook Live.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I did it last night while playing a little bit of Overwatch, played a couple games. Apparently, I don't know the settings because I did the one button and none of the sound recorded, so...
Okay, yeah. But is it just literally the stream of the game, or is it
you can
have voiceover and stuff like that?
Yeah, it can capture your mic as well as a webcam.
Okay,
I don't have a webcam, so I can't test that, and I don't even want to look at my ugly mug. But I need to get the voice stuff is kind of irritating because it's not push to talk. I need to go into the settings. What I need to do?
Yeah, because you can set it just all the way on, right?
Yeah. Okay. But it's
because it is annoying. I don't enjoy that.
Yeah, but it's Facebook Live, so you're familiar with that. People can like obviously watch it live. They can comment all that stuff. And it shows your little viewer account in this little tiny box at the top while you're playing.
Yeah,
very cool.
It's a live chat too, right? Because you can interact. You can see the chat or no?
No, I don't think so. I don't think you can see the comments.
Oh, okay. That's probably
but,
a good thing.
Yeah, Sarah left me a comment while I was...
There you go.
I couldn't see it, so...
There's your fan.
Yeah, but anyway, so they're going to be rolling that out soon. But yeah,
do you think
it's
supposed to be in competition to existing services? Because, I mean, they're using Facebook, so clearly Facebook is dumping money into Overwatch and Blizzard because Activision doesn't have enough money, apparently. Small startup.
Right. No, it's not. It's just a collaboration between the two companies just to make their games. I mean, obviously, to make it as easy as possible to get their games in any as many
what's the point?
Eyes out there. Yeah.
But obviously, right now, I would say probably Twitch is the big dog, right? And
yeah.
Twitch is owned by Google. Or
Amazon.
Alphabet.
Amazon.
Oh, Amazon owns Twitch.
Yeah, that was it was a rumor that Google was going to buy them.
And then Amazon.
And that's why they started YouTube Gaming.
It's weird how like Facebook owns like Oculus, right?
Uh-huh.
It's just weird. Like it's going to be one company, I'm telling you. I will soon to accept my overlords. Whether
my
it's
Google overlords.
Facebook, Amazon, Google. Anyways.
But yeah, it's very cool. Check it out.
I like the streaming stuff. It's weird because, you know, there's always a, why would you watch somebody play video games? Why don't you just play it? I don't know. It's different.
I watch this guy named Lyric. I watch his
very
stream.
Popular on Twitch, yeah.
Yeah.
But my it's usually like one of two reasons why I think most people watch people play video games. Either they're very good at it, and it's more of like a gladiator type of it's a watching somebody play a sport.
Well, it's not only that, but if you play the game as well, then it's like these are pros. You're getting tips from them and all that kind of stuff.
So. Right, or it's the personality because there are some people who aren't great. Like great at playing games, but they're funny and enjoyable, and they have
like
good
PewDiePie and all that stuff.
Right, they have good banter with no one on. You know what I mean, with a camera, which is hard to do,
or their chat. You know,
yeah, exactly. So,
also a couple of things. They there's a canon to this to all these characters, 21, well, not 22
stupid
heroes in this game.
I don't care.
But the number one rule is that the game is not canon.
Okay.
Which I know is kind of weird, because these are all the people that's in the same team fighting each other.
I got it,
But there's web series, they're like shorts, and they're actually really good. They're like Pixar quality.
Well, I saw that when you first boot up Overwatch, the gorilla guy talks to you for like a few minutes about the war and what happened, and I'm like, skip. Like, I was just like, because, I mean,
kinda cool.
Well, because it's an online-only game, so how far can they, and that's why they can't, they can build
the future,
a narrative.
David, the future.
Oh, you think they'll make a single-player game? I mean, the
I
game
think
has been successful.
Enough, you'll see a campaign.
Right, and that makes sense, but I mean, it's probably not going to be the same type of game. It'll be something else.
Yeah, maybe.
But it's always, I mean, if you have a, it's just like, that was the problem with, what was that one for Xbox One? The things fall down from the sky, the big mechs. What was that game called?
Titanfall?
Titanfall. Online only, so it's, there's no single player crafting a narrative
experience.
There's
no campaign components, which is.
That's what I mean, yeah. There's no single player narrative driven experience.
Yeah, yeah.
And because you have multiplayer, you cannot have a story,
which
right?
is why they're bringing it to Titanfall 2.
Right, exactly.
Enough people said that. But it's cool. They have, like I said, those shorts, which I definitely recommend watching. Even if you don't really care about the canon of the characters, just the animation is gorgeous. It's cool. You have, like, the two Genji brothers, or I forgot their last name, but Genji and Hanzo, their brothers fighting. It's cool. Anyways, they have that, and then they also have webcomics. I've read some of them. There's like 12 of them right now. They're short, but it just introduces these little characters. It's cool.
I mean, it's cool that they do that. And, Blizzard does great work with, full CGI.
Universe building.
Well, not just that, but just like their actual animation department. Like, remember back in the day, like.
No, all of them. Like, World of Warcraft, like, even when the Lich King came out,
that was like
the best cinematic trailer you've ever
that's
seen.
My point.
And the game is like crappy MMO.
And then someone made a movie about it, and we were like, why didn't you just make a long cinematic movie?
Exactly. So, Overwatch did a lot of that, obviously. Couple other things. Watch The Killing Joke, David.
Real quick, before you move on to that, I want to talk about Overwatch. So, like, what are your, like, top three favorite characters?
Okay, so right now, D.Va, with the changes they've made to her. She's my main right now.
So
much fun to play.
She's a like a mech. She has like a giant mech suit.
Yeah, she drives a mech. Your mech can blow up and you pop out and your next assault.
She reminds me of like a cross between like Mech Assault and Samus from Metroid.
Yeah, kind of. And her personality is cool. Her personality is like she plays online games. She's like GG and like stuff like that, which is kind of cool.
Very meta, yeah.
And then I like Torb on defense. He's the guy that builds a turret. He's the dwarf, you know. Yeah. Hard work plays off.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Okay.
That guy's cool. And then it's mixed between Soldier 76, which is like the guy you start with.
That's
the most typical.
Yeah, to give
FPS
me a machine
guy.
Gun.
Yeah,
and grenades.
And grenades
yeah. Okay.
Well, he doesn't have grenades, but yeah.
Grenades shoot out of his
the missile.
Like a, yeah,
right.
Whatever.
It's Helix missiles, David.
Stop it.
Or Roadhog. I like Roadhog.
See, I don't
the
enjoy.
Big fat guy with the chain.
I don't like any of the giant tank characters because I like speed. We talked about this last week when I was playing Doom. I enjoy like the speed. So Soldier
76.
He has like one of his abilities is just he can run.
Sprint, yeah.
Yeah, and that's like I wish every character had that.
You should check out Tracer
or
Genji.
Yeah, I think I would like Tracer.
But these are two characters that like if you become good at them, like they're super annoying. Like they're the most annoying
characters.
Right,
they're like Chun-Li bouncing all over the screen.
Yeah, but
right?
if you're not good at them then it's like you suck.
No, I know. I think it's just recently cuz I got through that Doom thing like everything feels super slow.
Let's try those out tonight.
I should try out Tracer. All right. Anyways, yeah, I'm
play
sure.
Those tonight.
Yeah, we'll play. We'll be.
You won't even know cuz this is 2 days in the past for you. Anyways, watch the Batman Killing Joke came out.
Yes,
on
the
digital download.
Animated movie from the Warner Brothers studio.
Yes, David. Let me preface this that I'm going to give my opinions on this.
Are you going to spoil anything?
Well, I mean, this has been a very popular comic.
Yeah,
I'll mention not specific beats, but overall. But anyways, I'll preface this by saying I'm not the biggest Batman fan.
Okay.
I think most people of this podcast would know. I'm not a big fan of Batman. I prefer Marvel characters, but even then I don't know like their backstories or the old comics.
You're a Marvel kid. That's fine.
Yeah, anyways,
all right, that's fine.
I never read this graphic novel when it came out.
Okay.
All I heard around it was very controversial.
Yes.
It had some graphic stuff in
Alan
it.
Alan Moore, yeah, definitely. It went
and he
further.
Later regretted the story.
I
shouldn't have did that. But anyway, I digress.
I think that was just to give more press. You know, it's like, I shouldn't have wrote it. And it's like, oh, even the author didn't thought it was so bad? Now I gotta read it.
Well,
I think
then
that's
I've heard
part
that
of it. I don't know.
This is one of the most popular Batman stories. It's in the canon of the Batman, like the way the Joker is presented and all that kind of
stuff. Right, right, right.
So I was like, oh, there's a lot of hype around this. I'm really excited to see this as someone who doesn't really like Batman, you know, whatever.
But you like the animated series. You like the...
No, yeah, I guess what I mean, I like Batman.
I'm not the biggest.
I don't know. I'm not the hugest Batman nerd. You know what
you
I mean?
Love Batman. You're just not in love with
exactly,
Batman.
Exactly.
Okay. Anyways.
Those bat nipples. Anyways.
So stupid.
Batman Forever. Such a
good... No, it's not.
Anyways. This is not good, David. The Killing Joke was not good.
Yeah, I watched it. It is very faithful to the original comic. In fact,
other than the very beginning, I think 30 minutes or so.
Yeah,
right?
The first act of the... Well, the comic, it's a comic book, so it's hard to make like a... How long was it? It's probably like an hour and 15, 20 minutes long, the animated
short,
movie.
Yeah.
So it's hard to stretch a... Like, probably... I forget how many pages it is, but I'm
I guess it's not very long.
No, it's not. So they had to add a kind of a first act to lead up to kind of the comic portion of this animated movie. And a couple... I think this... The Killing Joke suffers from... A couple problems. One is that we've told a lot of Batman stories in other medium and other media. Like a lot of what is in the Killing Joke is about the relationship specifically between Batman and the Joker and why they both either have to exist or they're the polar opposite of each other. Right?
Yeah, you can't have me with or you can't be you without me or something like that.
Right. Like a Joker wants Batman. He doesn't want to kill Batman because it's, you know,
there's no man without Joker. There's no Joker.
Right. And so there's a little bit of that. And then but a lot of the parts of the Killing Joke are about this idea of can someone become the Joker? Like, can you break somebody to the point in which they choose madness over you know, sanity.
Right.
And that's been done in a lot of movies. The one that jumps out at me that I thought was kind of tackles this issue of, do you do the despicable thing? You know, it's one of those things. Okay. Like it's pushing somebody beyond the point of doing the right thing, doing
right.
what's morally
their,
correct,
like,
despite
yeah.
the fact that everything in their body tells them to do something with vengeance or revenge. Right.
Right.
So, The Dark Knight. It's the scene with the two boats. Heath Ledger's Joker says, "I have a bomb on each one of them."
Wow, that is literally the same exact
thing. If you set the bomb off on the other one, then you live, and you don't know if the other people on the other boat.
Not
are
only good. That, but one boat is full of prisoners, so they're obviously going to be the ones you blow up. But the civilians, you know,
right?
He's
so,
trying to turn the civilians.
That's
into
the problem
murderers.
Is that the Killing Joke has a little bit of that motif running through it about, and in other animated Batman movies have tackled that issue. So this is a very celebrated comic and or graphic novel, whatever the hell you want to call it. I don't care what you call it, but because of all of the other times that we've seen this kind of played out and portrayed, it doesn't have the same punch as it did when it came out. But the issue here that or not the issue, but the reason why this is just, it doesn't matter is that Mark Hamill is the Joker's voice and Kevin O'Connor, I believe that's who does Batman's voices, do the original Batman animated series. So it doesn't matter because those two could literally just read the phone book and I'd just be in those voices and it would be great.
Yeah, but that their voices don't make this movie anything close to great.
I don't think
it's
bad.
Cool seeing
I don't think
them
it's bad. I think,
reprise their roles, but that's pretty much it.
But I think the reason why it's not, it doesn't have the same punch is because you've seen this before. You've seen the Joker make Batman and other characters have to make difficult choices, and
I honestly didn't make that connection. Like, well, I get what the meaning of it, but I didn't get the connection. Like, this has been done before.
Well, that's how I felt.
My thing was like it was more shock. Like, there was no real substance to the story, especially by the end.
That's the whole point of the end. That's the point. Is like it's kind of like.
Did I miss it?
I think you kind of miss it at the end. I actually like the ending of it. I'm not going to spoil it, but I like the ending of it because it's very faithful. But there are parts of this animated movie that are lifted, like,
well, that's the point.
Well, directly from the comic, which is okay, as long as it feels out of place. There's portions of this, like specifically, and this is not spoiling anything. There is a long prose or monologue that Joker goes on. Actually, it's dialogue. He's talking to somebody. Dialogue about something. In the comic book, it's a very long diatribe. He goes on for like 4 minutes of talking. A
lot of panels.
Right, which is just awkward for a animated movie. In a comic, it's different, right? Like,
yeah,
it's,
I guess.
It's what I always say, it's the participating media versus the non-participating. Like, if you're reading something, you're having to force your own ideas of what... You force motion. You force additional portions. Like, when you're reading a book.
You're doing the imagination in your head.
Right, right, right.
What they look like.
Right, whereas, like, a movie, or in this case, a cartoon... everything is just given to you. It's boiled. Yeah, exactly. It's spit right into your eyes, right? So there's less imagination. So it suffers from that. I'm glad they did it. I think it's a great story. They don't go, and maybe this is just my opinion, the R rating in this is a very, like, I don't know how it got the R.
I was expecting a lot more.
I think it's just because it's a cartoon.
So they're more in the graphic novel?
It goes a little, it insinuates a lot more. It definitely insinuates some more terrible things. I was surprised they did it here. But they didn't go as far as I thought they were going to go. But I think you have to remember, it's a Batman cartoon.
No, like, I know. But like, after seeing, like, I was like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, it's a little, like, for a cartoon, crap, for a cartoon that has Batman in it.
And you have that mentality of, like you said, the voices are there. So you have the mentality of the animated series. Like, you're a kid again. You're like, oh my God, he's taking off her shirt. Jesus
yeah, it's
Christ.
Weird. Yeah, it's a little weird. There's some, definitely some weird sexual assault stuff.
The saving grace of this movie for me is Joker's backstory. And
I like it better when he doesn't have a backstory.
Because I never knew any of that kind of stuff, and to me that's like new content, so it's interesting.
It's not new though. They've done that in games, in video games. They've hashed that out, and all of the Arkham games. I don't know if you've beat them, but they've gone over all this story.
I know.
That's why I'm saying it doesn't have the same thematic and storytelling and narrative punch, because I know all this, not just from the comic, but like I've seen it played out in animation through video games, and I personally like the idea of Joker's narrative being 10 million different things. I like the idea of Heath Ledger saying, you know, I got these scars, and it changes every time, so you never know how he actually got the scars. That's the whole point. It's like, where does crazy come from? Like, I don't want to know.
True.
It's even creepier when I don't know. Because here's the idea. If I know what made you the Joker, then maybe I can fix you. But if I don't know, then I don't know I don't know how to, that's even frightening. That's
well, I guess this movie totally went over my head, and that's why I didn't like it.
I think
next thing.
it's worth seeing. It's worth renting. I wouldn't buy it. There's much better animated movies with Batman in them. It's good that they did it. They can kind of check that off the box. Now there was some controversy surrounding it, which you told me at Comic-Con.
Yeah, at Comic-Con, because the first 30 minutes tell Batgirl's story, and Batgirl is obviously a very important heroine in that DC universe. She's a strong female character, which is something you don't see very often.
Right.
And the first 30 minutes of this movie kind of makes her into a more hollow, shallow person who's just doing it for Batman's...
well, she's just doing it for to draw the
his attention of a man.
His attention, yeah.
And so a lot, there was a, you know, fans were asking questions to the writers at the panel and stuff.
Why did you do that? Why did you choose that story over...
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, one of the writers got upset. Check it out. It's a...
No, like the writers on the panel started having an argument within
themselves. Yeah, exactly. And yeah, just check it out. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. And so for me, I understand what they were trying to go for. Once you see the movie, I think it makes more sense. Or the animated movie or whatever you want to call it.
It's a movie, David.
But it kind of falls flat because it's, I don't know. It's hard to explain. I'm not a director and I'm definitely not a writer, but it just didn't feel, it felt weird.
It felt hollow to me.
Well, it just felt like, okay. There's just not enough motivation there. I don't know. It's weird because, like, I don't mind taking characters and giving them new backgrounds and new things like that, but you also have to be very careful because you're going to clearly draw, you know, why are you doing
and
that?
And not just that, but, like, especially in this day and age when they're, like, these kind of properties are desperate to find strong female minority characters and stuff and trying to bring them in.
Yeah.
And this is the perfect opportunity to sell that, you know, to mm-hmm. a new generation. And they just...
There's just also things in the this is more Batman. We'll do a Batman. We've already done a Batman episode. I could do a whole other one. We'll get to that later.
Maybe when
some other
Batman
day.
Comes out with his first Batfleck comes out with his
yeah
first
exactly movie. I got lots of stuff to talk about, but let's go on. Let's move
so
on.
Next thing, got a couple other things here. Cracker Barrel, iconic Southern comfort food restaurant.
Yes, if you don't
opens
know.
In Vegas. Open in Vegas. Just technically Tenderson.
4 days ago or something.
5 days ago.
By
the time we're recording.
Yeah, normally you have to go to like the closest places like Utah or Arizona or like California. I think they're in California.
I don't think they're in California. I mean, I don't remember seeing them in SoCal when I lived there.
There's too many progressives living out there. I'm just kidding.
Anyways, so I want to see what the hype was about. Apparently this was a big deal. Cracker Barrel is amazing. They got the front porch, David.
Yeah, it's definitely, it looks like an old school restaurant, like a mom and pop.
They have a big gift shop, kind of like a Rainforest Cafe when you first walk in. They sell clothes and like all this ridiculous
stuff.
They have toys, old candy, they have preserves.
Yeah, you get a...
Jar, they, or a, Yeah, just
jams,
like pickled
and jellies.
Garlic,
yeah, exactly. They have the area where you can go pick rocks. Remember when you're a kid and you'd buy like the rocks?
Yeah, yeah.
And then like, oh, do you have any like wind-up toys? Gotta get those. Got wind-up toys. How about a mood ring? You want a mood ring?
Yeah, all that stuff's there and it's cool. They have like a UNLV section. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So
anyways, so we, wife and I went there last night.
How long was the wait?
They told us an hour and a half to 2 hours. Jeez. It was very busy. And if you know the restaurant, they have a big porch of rocking chairs, which is kind of cool. And they had misters out for one.
Did they
that
have
thing
a,
was packed.
Do they have chess? They always have like a
checkers.
Checkers. Oh, yeah. A
couple checkers like, tables.
Listen, we're not elite. We play checkers.
This is a South, dude.
I'm from the South, so that's okay.
Yeah.
I'm from Texas, so it's okay.
Anyways.
We play checkers.
Ended up waiting about an hour, so it went quicker. So I think it's the more like under-promise, over-deliver.
Yeah,
kind
it's
of
always
thing.
A good idea.
Yeah, good idea. And it was worth it, David. This food was amazing.
Yes.
I literally felt like I was at my great-grandma's kitchen.
Yep.
My brother and I would go over. She's like, what do you want for lunch? And she brings out six different random things. And because you order like your meal and you get three sides. I, David, ordered the, I like to call it the tour of Italy of the South.
Yes. So what do we call
their
it?
Sampler.
Tour of Arkansas.
Yeah. Came with chicken and dumplings, David. That's
yep.
how it's spelled.
Chicken and
on the
dumplings.
Menu.
Question. Wait, before you move on, we got to talk about what kind of chicken and dumplings because there's different types.
I will explain to that because
okay.
I have a question right, about chicken and dumplings.
Yes. I might have an
chicken
answer.
Chicken and dumplings, excuse
yes,
me.
Exactly.
Meatloaf and sugar ham. There's like sugar cured ham.
Yes.
And it came with three sides. I got mac and cheese. Cheese grits, doubled up on the cheese there, David.
Smart.
Because why not? And then summer salad, which is like a cucumber, tomato, onions. I mean, I got two cheese entrees, David. I got to split up a little bit with the veg. Come on now.
So apparently your Pokemon Go, you've lost a lot of calories, but you're going to make it all up right
exactly.
here.
Exactly. And then you had a choice of buttermilk or cornbread muffins or one of each. David, I went with one of each. Because why wouldn't you, right?
Why not?
When in Rome.
Come on. Exactly.
When in Arkansas. Yeah.
When in Arkansas.
And then I got sweet tea. So let me review my meal here, David.
Okay, so let's start it off.
Sweet tea is probably the best sweet tea I've ever had.
You think so?
For one. Yeah, because like you have like, okay, I like tea a lot, and I like sweet tea a lot. You have quite the spectrum here. You have like super sweet, like McDonald's or like Mexican restaurants are super sweet, and those can be good. And then
but
you
it's
have
not like something.
Not
see, when it's too sweet, I can't drink it like a beverage. I have to drink it like a dessert. You know what I mean?
I can, but you feel like garbage
No,
afterwards.
But that's my point. Like, it's not like... It's not palate cleansing like a normal drink would be. It's more just like, I'd like a dessert in the middle of my salad.
Exactly. but this tea was just perfect. It's perfect amount of sugar.
See, it needs
so
to be more
good.
Lemony than it needs to be sugary for
well, see,
me.
She served it with lemon. I'm like, that's weird because normally you don't get lemon with sweet tea.
You're right.
But when you mix it,
it's good. That's good.
So that was just the drink, David. Just wait till I get to
it. All right. So it was just a drink.
All right. So chicken and dumplings, right?
Yes.
So as far as I know, it's kind of like chicken noodle soup with big all noodles. Is that correct?
There's two different ways you can make chicken and dumplings.
Okay.
The way you are, the soup style where it's, like soup with bits of like noodle type thing. That's one way. Another way is kind of like a casserole with biscuit dough put on certain, like all over. Mm-hmm. And then that cooks up in certain areas and then you kind of take like,
scoop it out, right?
Like think of like a...
It's like a thick stew almost?
Think of like a, the equivalent would be like a chicken pot pie inside. The inside of a chicken pot pie with biscuit dough topped on top.
So definitely not that. It's
yeah, that's
the one
a different
with like style. Big pieces of noodle. It feels like, is it pasta?
Yeah, it's like a pot. It's yeah, sort of.
Yeah,
it's a potato-y pasta type thing. Yeah,
that. And like it's not like a soup. It's more like a like the casserole, like inside like a creamy,
like a chowder.
Yeah, very good. Chicken is amazing.
Yeah,
except that my
both are good.
My dumplings, they were like four stacked on top of each other, so it was just a big mass of like dough.
Are you complaining?
No, it's still good.
The dumplings the best part of chicken and dumplings.
Yeah, so that was excellent. The meatloaf was a little dry, but just really good. A lot of flavor.
Did it have like a sauce, like a meatloaf sauce, like a ketchup glaze?
Yeah, it had the typical like on the top. It was just a slice. You got the
top
of there.
Okay.
Yeah, so
okay.
Solid. And then the sugar.
Wait,
ham,
wait, wait, wait. Meatloaf. Did it have bits of like vegetable in it? Because I have a big problem.
Little tiny. I think they're a veg. Definitely onions, but I thought I saw some green.
Yeah, I don't. I like veggie-less meatloaf. Like, you know, you can mix
it's called a meatloaf, not a meat and veg loaf.
No, but I'm talking like you can see the bits of, it's almost like when they put carrots in jello. I'm like, what are you doing?
Gross.
Why are you doing that?
Yeah. Stop it.
Stop it.
Stop right
trying
now.
To make me eat carrots. It's not
I'm not going to do it, Mom.
I mean, carrot cake is good, but you got to put a lot of cream cheese frosting on that, all right?
So it knows julienne carrots got to be real thin, man. Don't mess with me here on this. Anywho, and then the sugar ham was, of course,
sugar
amazing.
Ham is probably the one that piqued my interest. I love ham and I love like the good glaze on a ham is like amazing. It's like candy.
Yeah, it was just a couple slices. Like I said, this is the sampler we got going.
Yeah, they're
on
not
here.
Gonna.
So they're small portions. But yeah, the crust was really good, super sweet. Okay. Just really good. Super.
I'm
juicy.
Actually really hungry now. But
oh, we should go.
Yeah, we should go.
And wait for 2 hours.
Sides, mac and cheese. Okay.
Yes, mac and cheese. Oh, that mac and cheese. So good.
Yellow or white? Is it like a white colored cheese or a yellowy cheese?
No, it's your traditional yellow.
Okay, because you can have mac and cheese with like a white cheese, you know, like a Vermont cheddar.
Yeah, if you're going to go classy with thumbs out with it. Okay. Or pinkies out with it. You don't
okay.
want to do that.
So it's just a straight up mac and cheese?
Yeah, definitely a couple cheeses going on there. I don't know, but it tasted really good.
Okay.
And then the cheese grits were not very good. I shouldn't have ordered them, honestly. I'm trying to get into these grits. I'm not a grits person.
See,
but I had some good,
It's just polenta. I mean, I know I'm probably
we had some really good cheese
Southern.
Polenta at this restaurant right. at Bellagio. We're
yeah,
trying to find
it's the same thing.
This one, just say that oatmeal with like some cheddar on top was all right.
Wow,
not very
that
good.
Makes it sound really bad.
Yeah.
No, cheese grits are good. I'm not a huge grits guy. Like I said, I prefer like almost any other side, like cream spinach. Get down to some cream spinach. Like, get down. I will eat, like, Popeye would be impressed. I'd eat so much damn cream spinach.
And then I had the summer salad, which is good. You got the tomatoes.
That's just
you got
the
a vinaigrette. It's typical.
Whatever.
It's just tomatoes, cucumbers, onion. You don't like summer salad? Wait, I used to make my
Wait,
own summer...
Wait, tomatoes, cucumbers, and what?
Onion. Like red onion.
Oh.
The summer salad. That and just,
That's
like,
what
toss
that's called?
Vinaigrette. Yeah.
It's okay.
Really? Okay, so... Little,
Wait, did you have a choice? Did
here.
You have a choice of a third... Like yeah. a different, you could have went with something else?
Yeah, three sides. You get three sides.
Where was the cream spinach, bro?
I know. So
you don't
I,
like
I
cream
feel
spinach?
Like the summer salad. It was really hot outside. So, back in the day, babe. Or
babe. Hey. Wait.
David is
hey,
what I meant
listen.
To say.
It's okay.
Been friends for a long time. at the ranch. We used to grow our own cucumbers and tomatoes and make our own summer salad.
Okay. So well, see, this is the difference. Okay, and a lot of people probably have never had a fresh tomato.
Mm-hmm.
But a fresh tomato tastes a lot different than what you get
you
at a
eat
grocery.
Like an apple.
Well, that and it tastes different. Like, it tastes yeah. better. It tastes more tomatoey. The only time tomato stuff tastes like tomato, in all honesty, is when you buy the cans. And I know that sounds weird. Cans of whole tomato from mm-hmm. good companies. Because they cook them and right off the vine. And so, I don't know. It just
on the vine tomatoes you can get that are sometimes good. But mostly the other ones are just white.
Well, they just taste like nothing. Because it's, yeah. it's, you know, like
it's
all
like
of...
water, like watermelon. It's just, except not sweet. Just water...
Yeah.
Nothing.
So, anyways.
Anyway, so yeah, good stuff. Good
That's
stuff.
Why you like it because you have nostalgia.
But like,
how was
the...
which one was better? We've got a buttermilk biscuit and a cornbread muffin.
Oh yeah, whoa! Almost
this
forgot
is
about
the, this is the real
cornbread muffin is good. I like a sweet cornbread muffin, which just was not. But it
That's
was good.
The Southern style is not sweet. It's a we make one in it that I make from Cook's Country, which is probably one of my favorite places. If you want to learn how to cook, go to PBS Cook's Country or. America's Test Kitchen.
I've heard of America's Test Kitchen. I have that guy's book.
Yeah, so it's amazing, but they make there's a cornbread recipe that it's a Southern style cornbread and it's very corn flavored.
Yeah, yeah.
And
it's
Alyssa
good, tardy,
Alyssa
good.
Loves it. She does not like the sweet cornbread.
Oh, I like the sweet cornbread.
Me too.
And like butter,
I know,
so
me
good.
Too. I'm saying
but the biscuit, oh my god, David, the biscuit.
The honey
the
buttermilk
biscuit, yeah. So good. My wife got chicken fried steak, and I took some of her gravy.
The gravy,
and,
the sawmill oh, gravy? So white gravy, right?
Yes,
okay,
course,
good,
course,
good, good, good. Just checking. Hey, you can put brown gravy on a chicken fried steak if you want to go move to a different country.
Anyway, before I get to the dessert, David, everything just together just tasted so good. Like I said, I felt like I was at my great-grandma's house.
That's good.
Getting lunch. All the sides came on separate little bowls, just like your grandma would
take a nap
too.
On the porch.
I should have.
On that rocking chair.
Just really good. Check it out. It's great.
And they're not terribly expensive. I mean,
no,
it's not. It's like, well, it's probably like, what, for yours, it would sound like there's probably a little bit
David.
Of coin there. But
so I had a blackberry cobbler, which is,
oh my God.
David, so
did they put
with
like
a scoop of vanilla ice cream.
I was going to say
top.
They put, and it melted partly.
And it was like good vanilla ice cream,
yeah.
too.
Yeah,
so
you can see the flecks of vanilla bean in it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay. With my meal, and Sarah got her chicken fried steak meal, a couple sides as well, and then a apple pie.
She got apple pie.
She got apple pie.
I'm not a fan of apple pie.
She took it home. She was too full.
Yeah.
Anyway, so of course.
Yeah.
But all of that, with two drinks, I got tea and she got like a Coke or something. It was like $36.
Yeah, so $40.
We got a lot of food.
Well, for you, it's like $37. That's an inside joke
That's
there.
That's a callback right there. But yeah, really, really good food. I recommend everyone go check it out. I'm definitely going to go back. They do have a breakfast. You can order breakfast anytime, by the way. And I was so close ordering breakfast, but I'm like, breakfast food is really hard to kind of, I mean, it's going to be amazing, but like. This is the Southern cooking food, you know. I gotta eat that.
Yeah, it's really good. Every time we go, it's like that road trip food.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's definitely that. But it's nice that we have one here. I wish it wasn't across the city. It feels like
for you, you're even closer than we are.
I know, but it's like everything here is like 30 minutes away.
Yeah. It was like it took us 30 minutes to get back home.
Yeah. I'll wait till it dies down a little bit. But it is funny that it's at the Silverton, right?
Which yep, right behind it.
They
it's
are
not in it. It's like a right behind it.
Yeah, but they got like the Bass Pro Shop over there. Yeah. They got the Silverton. Now they know what they're marketing to.
Oh yeah, they're like, it's literally the south part of Vegas.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's definitely worth it. So I would recommend checking that out. We had a cousin. They do this all the time. They'll get us gift cards to restaurants that aren't in Vegas.
Jerks.
I know. So we have a gift card to Cracker Barrel. So now we can finally use it. Yeah. Or we would go on road trips with them. That was the whole joke. One year he got my sister, I think it was like $100 in or what are they called? Gift certificates, not gift certificates. You know, when you might not know this in Vegas, when you cash out now, you don't
get
like a little receipt.
Cash receipt.
Yeah, and you bring it up to the cashier and they give you actual money. He went to like 10 different casinos and got $10. So she had to go to every casino to turn it in.
So like he got back home where Vegas is not in.
Yeah.
And gave her, here you go, here's $100. I got you. You got to go back to Vegas to redeem it, though.
Right.
It's kind of cool because you're like forcing the trip.
But not just that, but she had to go to like 10 different casinos to turn them in. It was pretty funny. Anyways.
So yeah, check it out. It's great. And then the last thing I got here is I finished this book I was reading, in between Star Wars books. If you're on our YouTube, you can see the book.
Yeah, props.
This is Armada, written by Ernest Cline. This is his second book after Ready Player One, which I'm pretty sure I talked about on the show. I think we were doing the podcast when I finished that book. But this kind of fits the same mold. It's sci-fi, video game stuff, tons of 80s references.
Is it set in the like 80s?
No, it's in the modern times. Here's kind of the general plot. Well, I'm not spoiling anything here, but for years there have been obviously science fiction
hold
movies.
On, hold
and
on,
video games.
Hold on. The main character's name is Zach Lightman.
Yeah, his of dad's name is Xavier Lightman.
Yeah, you know what? That's all you needed to say. Come on.
It's about the kid who really is good at playing the specific video game called Armada, created by this company who makes another game, and really good at playing games about fighting the... God, I'm really explaining this horribly.
It's a coming-of-age adventure.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks for reading the side of the book. Anyway, he plays this game about fighting aliens, all this stuff, and suddenly... Maybe the game is more real than he thought.
Oh, no.
Dun, dun, dun. But it's really good. It's a real fun read.
It's not too long. It's
350 pages.
Yeah, like
that.
Yeah, that's good.
But if you've read Ready Player One, it's kind of the same like sci-fi-ness with all the cool 80s references and the video game stuff.
Yeah, if you like video games, this is definitely the way to go, right?
Yeah, really good book. Check it out.
This is, you said, his second book, right?
His second book, yeah. Already been picked up for a movie. If you know, Spielberg is doing Ready Player One. I think it comes out next year. It was kind of funny, David. His third book got optioned for like a seven-figure deal.
Must
with
be
a
nice.
Picture.
Well, we got a second seven-figure deal for our third podcast, but I just didn't want, you know, I didn't want money to influence this podcast, so I told them no.
Oh, I would sell. I'll sell that right now, David.
For like $15.
Yeah.
What do you want me to advertise?
Advertise anything. I'll do anything.
Anyways.
Yeah, check it out. Give it a 4 out of 5.
On what? Amazon or something? Are you one of those
guys? No, fine. I'll give it a 7 out of 9.5.
That's good. Okay. Is it better than the first book, Ready Player One? Is it set in the same world?
No, not in the same universe.
Okay.
Because Ready Player One is set in like kind of post-apocalyptic future. This is more modern times. I think that the year is like 2018 by the time this book ends. So it
seems like it says there's a lot of inside meta jokes. Like
This is all for Ready Player One.
Oh, okay.
Praise for Ready Player One.
Oh, okay. See, I find that weird. I mean, I understand. Like, hey, did you like my first book? You love my second book, right?
It's a blur, but it's like I don't want you to read my second book.
What do you mean?
Well, that's these are called blurbs, right?
No, I know, but it's just weird for the back of the book to talk all about his first book. It's like, why don't you tell me what they said about your new book? But anyways.
Well, his first book.
4 out of 5. We can just write that in with a pen on the back here.
Yeah, Gerald, sit down, Sanders.
Cool.
But yeah, definitely check it out if you like these kind of books. And obviously check out Ready Player One if you have not read that as
just
well.
A more general question. Are you a guy that keeps this this paper cover on? I just take these off and throw
them
away.
While I read? You throw them away?
Yeah, I just throw these away. I don't like the outside. You're that guy?
That's heresy.
You
want to
hear
I don't have it on here, when I read it. I take it off and put it on the bookshelf.
Yeah.
You know, and then when I read it, because I don't get my grubby hands
it's
all over.
It's the same thing
with... David, YouTube, look at this. If David threw this away, this is a graphic of the Interceptor in the book.
How do you
throw that away, David? I would almost frame this. If I was that much of a...
Here, I'll tell you all the other... Here, I'm gonna call myself out here. Inserts on board games, throw those away.
What's an insert? Like the books?
No, the inserts on like board games, like unless they're set, like they have little like containers, like areas for things that fit specifically.
Uh-huh.
Like if it's just a divider, like some of them will just have like, oh, you put the cards in the middle and the board sits on top. I throw all that out. And some board gamers are like, what? That's part of the game.
I don't care about that so much.
No, and
like,
the same thing with like the sleeve. Sometimes you buy even a DVD or a video game or whatever, and it has the jewel case, you know, like the actual thing, and then it comes with like a sleeve over the top of it. I throw that away too.
Most time I would that as well.
See, I don't know. I used to.
This is like the limited edition tin. Can't throw that out, man.
All right.
No, but how dare you throw those out? I'm
sorry,
David.
Man. I
how
don't
dare
care.
You.
I, you know what it is. Well, now I've moved.
Why would you throw it out?
I have less and less of that stuff because I just buy it all digitally now, like Kindle and stuff like that. So I don't have to worry about it. I just don't care. I'm like, because it gets in the way, it gets ripped.
Well, no, you put it somewhere else while you're reading it. And then when you're done with it, put it back on the book and put it in your bookshelf.
I have enough junk in my life, man. I got junk in my trunk.
You're junk. Anyway, that's all I got. Definitely read the book. David, what's
that?
Doing?
All you got?
Yeah. Okay. I talked about Dave, I've been talking for like a half hour. Okay. People are done with me. They're over my voice, David.
All right. Let's talk about what I did for the week. Okay. First thing, I watched a new television show that is premiered on HBO a couple weeks ago called Vice Principals.